Hey guys, it's Danny. Today we're gonna take a look at my Polychilus type Phalaenopsis orchids. These are the summer bloomers, the really, really pretty ones. It is time to shower them because they're quite dusty. So I will take all of these guys down, take them outside, shower them, and practically leave them outside for half a day to properly dry. And of course, I wanna treat them as well with my maintenance treatment, which I will link you to down below. Anyway, since I'm doing it, I thought it would be a great idea to just make a little update on them because not only do they deserve an update, but also I have been growing them under these Gemma grow lights for the past almost half a year or so, less than that. I'll link you to the video that I made on these bulbs down below in the description so you learn more about them. And I have to say, I think I'm really happy, really, really happy with the result. I will get them down, of course, not film them under this light because you cannot really tell. My camera settings are way off just to be able to actually show you the actual orchids. In reality, the light is white, but the cameras have real issues capturing the proper light. So I'll take them to my usual spot, to the filming table, and I'll try to do a sort of then and now comparison with the spotlights that I will show you. So don't forget to give this video a like if you end up enjoying it, and why not subscribe? I post 3 times a week. So with that said, let's go to the filming table. By the way, here's a little sneak peek at the bare shelf. I decided to raise some of them in the back just to create this nice cascading effect. I don't know, it gives dimension. And I did so by using these decorative pots turned upside down and raising the orchids on them. First off, here's the wonderful Phalaenopsis bellina. And besides the point, but yes, finally I got myself a little podium, a little holder here. Thank you for all of your suggestions. I did try to find cake holders and all things of sorts without luck, not even on Amazon. I'm not even kidding. I was looking for something very specific and behold, I find this, I don't know, decorative piece. I think it's a Christmas piece at a flower shop, but hey, it works. It doesn't really distract from the orchid. Anyway, bellina. Do you guys remember how awful this one looked? She has, I think she still has, the orchid fleck virus. It is an ailment which creates a lot of chlorosis spots on the leaves. And you can see previous damage here. And I didn't think it would make it. I was looking into a replacement, but look at that. I think she will be okay. I don't think she will ever be super perfect. But that's okay, the flowers are amazing. This is such a good form. And by the way, this is the Poncam variety. I have her for 5 years already. And for an orchid that has a virus, she's resilient. She's been through the move, through the thrips, through the spider mites, through the inorganic medium, through everything pretty much. And she's still here. And look how beautiful she looks today. She is producing multiple flowers at the same time, which she never ever actually did. So this is the first time she does this. Also, the newer leaf is bigger than the older one. And I don't know if it's because of the lights, obviously. It might just be because finally she's not that stressed, but I'm really happy with the color of the leaves. And you'll see with other orchids what I mean. But yeah, for now, I just wanted to show you the beautiful bellina, which is, it's kind of like an old friend. I have a video which I believe is my most popular video on my channel with the do's and don'ts of orchid growing, and in that video I hug her, and really honestly that's how I feel about her. I just feel like I want to hug her. She's like an old friend. Oh, and let me just clarify the gender thing really, really fast because I know some people get confused. It all has to do with the grammar of my language, which is a Latin origin language. See, in Latin, nouns have genders, and the adjectives we use will take a different form depending on the noun's gender. I'll give you an example. See, this leaf, it's pretty round, and I think you guys have the word in English as well, rotund, right? Well, that's a Latin word, and in Romanian, it's the same word. So if I want to say that this leaf is round, I'm not going to say rotund. I'm going to say rotundă, because the leaf is feminine. And if it were a masculine noun, then I would definitely say rotund. So it is so embedded in me that certain words have genders that I'm going to call a Dendrobium a he and a Phalaenopsis a she, or a Cattleya a she, because that's how it feels more natural to me. But it has nothing to do with anything else. Orchids don't have female flowers or male flowers, generally speaking. They don't have genders or things of the sort. They're just plants. It's just very hard for me to shake this off. So just wanted to clarify that. Alright, next up, a Phalaenopsis, which I hoped it would change, and it did. This is the Phalaenopsis Bashi Red Sun. I ordered it at the beginning of the year, and if you remember, the leaves were super red. She is a big anthocyanin producer. And initially, of course, I kept her under the LED panel, which is very bright, but moreover, it has a lot of yellow in the spectrum. And I was saying that, you know what? I want to see if this orchid will start to diminish its anthocyanin production when we switch spectrum. And it did. It definitely does not look as red as it used to be, and I cannot complain about the growth at all. The new leaf is much bigger than the previous one. The orchid is still blooming. It is a summer blooming orchid, so it does not produce a lot of flowers at once. It is sequential to some extent, and the flowers last a very long time in comparison to others. So with this one, indeed, the pigmentation changed according to the spectrum, and of course the intensity. But since I have them so close to the grow light, I don't know if the intensity was the cause of the change or the yellow spectrum, or lack thereof. Two more orchids that I wanted to showcase are some older orchids in my collection. This is the Penang Girl crossed with Violacea. And this is the Phalaenopsis Super Zebra. You might know the flowers of this one. They look a little bit like the Violacea, but look what happened in the past year. We produced the biggest leaf so far, and I do have this orchid for 2 or 3 years already. And with this one, pretty much the same. We did produce the biggest leaf ever since I received it, at least. And the color changed dramatically. I will look into the archive. I hope I can find some old footage. This one had really, really pale leaves. This one too, not as much as this one, but I still believe the color intensified on this one as well. We have a second flower spike as well, even though this one is still active. One of the things that I did notice generally with all of my Phalaenopsis, and one of the things that I wanted to fix, was the yellow leaves. They weren't yellow per se, they were just very pale. And well, Phalaenopsis are lower light plants, and I used to have them under pretty bright light. I then put them under dimmer light, but I still felt that the color of the leaves is not what it should be, really. And I think it has to do with the spectrum. That's actually the main thing I was hoping to achieve, a better leaf color, and I did achieve it. And since you saw some of these orchids are raised and very close to the light, and they still change their color, I don't think it's an intensity related issue, it was a spectrum related issue. Definitely going to investigate this, but I have to say I really like the color of my Phalaenopsis now, and you will see with others as well. So here are two phals which in my opinion changed colors a lot. First of all, the Phalaenopsis Sogo Grape. I've had this one for a few years, and it was really pale at some point. And when I last showed it to you, it was in April, I believe. March or April, she was in bloom, and I think you can see on the leaves that the color is a little bit pale. And now I can definitely see a difference in the coloration of the leaves. And both of these are actually sitting up, so closer to the light. And the next one is the Phalaenopsis Zengmin Muscadine variety Boihar. I actually named this variety for one of my viewers in memory of his mother, and look at her. She has a bud. I cannot wait to see her in bloom, but that's not the point. Look at her leaves. I think I see a major color change. I'll insert a picture of how it looked like when I received it. Look at the leaf below it, which is completely shaded by the upper leaf. Do you see the difference in color? Now, it would make sense because this is a shaded leaf. The orchid doesn't need to put so much chlorophyll into this leaf. We talked about this before. Whenever leaves get shaded like this, they do actually allocate less chlorophyll. But if my memory serves it right, this is the color it had when I received it. So the color is much, much more vibrant. It is not dark. This is not what's happening here. It is just vibrant. It's full of chlorophyll. And it just looks to me healthier. Not to mention the orchids are growing pretty great. This one did not have roots when I received it. Now she's okay. So I do see good growth and good color so far. Now, even so, I still have two Phalaenopsis that still don't look like they should. Maybe they're a little bit improved. I have to check the footage myself, and I will see it when I edit this video. So this is the Phalaenopsis Boni Vasquez. No, it's actually Orchid World Boni Vasquez. It's a beautiful orchid, never excelled for me. So I don't know if there's something wrong with this orchid. She's not sick. She has roots, as you can see. The medium could use a change. It's a little old at this point, but it's okay. And this is a newer one, let's say. This is the Phalaenopsis Friday Prince. Both of these were a little yellowish. And as we can see, they're still kind of pale. I think this shows a little bit of an improvement. Maybe this one? I don't think so. So I really hope that with this too, I'm not dealing with a deeper problem. Of course, I was not hoping that the light change will solve all of my problems. Of course, I need to support their growth with nutrients, which I do, but I did not change my fertilizer regime, the water that I use, and the medium. Some of these orchids have been potted a year and a half ago. I did not use the slow-release fertilizer. I did not change anything in my routine other than the light. So all of the orchids, I can tell for a fact, they changed color. These ones, not so much. So I don't know if there is a problem with these ones. We'll just have to wait and see. Maybe they're a little slower to react. They also didn't grow any new leaf just yet. So even growth is not up to par. But we'll see what happens. I think it changed a little bit in color, but not as much as the others. Here's another one that I have for a few years. It was looking a little bit like the Boni Vasquez. I thought they had the same issue since they come from the very same source. But no, look at this. This one actually grew one new leaf, and look how beautiful the new leaf is in comparison to the older leaves, which are just not up to par, in my opinion. So the new leaf definitely has a better color, definitely has a better shape. Can we see? And the glossiness is not a criteria. Most new leaves are glossy on these orchids, but the color and the shape, it just looks much more healthy, or actually healthier on the new leaves. Another one that I seem to have gotten a good color on is the Tyne Sheen Fly Eagle. This one has always been okay. I cannot complain. But I do believe that the newer leaves are much more vivid than the older leaves. These are very old leaves. I have this orchid for a lot of time, actually. So something like this, it will fall. It's okay. It's super old. Also, take a look at this. The new flower spikes, they are much greener than the older flower spike, which is this one. We can see that this one is longer. Look at this. Whatever grew now, it's a lot darker. And I think I see a darker section on this one as well. This is recent growth as well. But this is old growth and it has a different color, which is fascinating. So in this case, the major difference is on the very, very, very new growth, including flower spikes. Now, with this one, this morning I actually saw two thrips on it. I still have some thrips issues, but I have my trusty leaf shine spray that I use against them, and it's okay. I pretty much spot treat, of course, together with my spider mite treatment, which works against these as well. It's not as efficient. These ones are much more resilient, but with the spray, I can actually solve my issues, and all of my Phalaenopsis are pretty okay at this point. But when they have flowers, I sometimes can see thrips damage. And in this case, I caught them. And don't worry, they're not alive anymore. I sprayed the flower on the spot. This will also make the flower drop. But this orchid has already been in bloom for a while. All of the flowers are ready to drop anyway. You can see this one is naturally dropping. So that's okay. But all the more reason to give these guys a good shower and a preventative treatment. Two more that I wanted to show you. This is the Phalaenopsis tetraspis C1. It's not a very old orchid. I actually bought it a few months ago, maybe at the beginning of the year or ending of last year. And it's the orchid that I managed to break the top leaf off. But it's okay, it created a brand new leaf, and look at the color. These are the older leaves the orchid came with. Again, I see a pattern here. I do feel like the newer growth looks better. The older growth, not so much. It is very clear that the priority is the new growth, whether it's leaves or even flower spike. Now, Phalaenopsis tetraspis has always been a super pale orchid for me, and not this one necessarily, but the ones that I had in the past. Always, always, always pale. I thought it was just the trait of the orchid, and maybe it is. Maybe it is prone to being paler than maybe the fly eagle, right? But look at this girl now. This, I've never had a tetraspis C1 this color. And again, this orchid has no slow-release fertilizer inside. I did not treat her. I don't think I actually bought the slow-release fertilizer yet when I potted this orchid. It's just my typical mixture, just the MSU fertilizer and the reverse osmosis water that I've always used. I did not really change anything else with these orchids, just to see the effect of the grow light. And if this is all due to the spectrum, oh boy, what a difference. I'm in disbelief, to be fully honest. And the last orchid that I wanted to show you, I've actually received this one from one of you lovely people. This is the Phalaenopsis gigabell. So, Veronica, look at her. Do you remember she was not looking all that great root-wise? Well, now we grew some roots, but not only that. Check out her new leaf. Oh my goodness, it is the largest leaf on the entire orchid, which means I did good. Now, this particular orchid, since it is a Gigantea hybrid, it does have a bit of a gray cast on her leaves, and that's absolutely normal. It doesn't need to be that apple green that we're used to with the Violacea. So the shade is supposed to be a little grayish, but the size and the overall coloration and just overall look of the new leaf is wonderful. And again, we don't have a great root system here. We have enough to sustain this orchid's growth, but we have a brand new leaf which is bigger than the others, looking like this. And this again is closer to the light, so it's raised. And it also has the wall in the back that reflects light, so even more light. So it doesn't have to do with the intensity of the light. I do believe it has to do with the spectrum, and I cannot believe that there is such difference. Okay, so these were the highlights that I wanted to show you guys. Now about the showering part. In cultivation, showering or pouring water on top of Phalaenopsis is a little bit of a delicate subject because since we grow them upright, and yes, my orchids are already leaning, that's their nature, they're not leaned all the way like they would be on the trunk of a tree. They're still potted, they will still accumulate pools of water in the crowns, in between the leaves. It is the nature of how we grow them. So because of this, we need to be very, very careful with how we shower them and how we pour liquids in general on top of their leaves. I typically shower them in the summertime. I did the very, very, very stupid mistake, really, last year to shower them in October or November. Mind you, I do have extended summers, and I thought, oh, the hot temperatures will last all the way to December, and I was wrong. All of a sudden, the weather changed, and that impacted the temperature in my green room, and I lost a lot of Phalaenopsis due to crown rot this winter, more than in my entire orchid collection experience. And that was a mistake on my part. So this year, I'm showering them in July. I'm treating them in July. The weather outside is hot, just how these orchids like it, actually. They're hot growers. And this will help with water evaporation. Now, showering is great for these orchids because you are eliminating the dust from their leaves. Also, I'm hoping to eliminate some of the thrips, if I still have any. And of course, with the preventative spider mite treatment, I keep them safe from spider mite. But in order to be safe with this, I'm actually going to leave them on the terrace for at least half a day for all the water to evaporate in the heat, in the breeze. And if I so desire, I will keep them all day and I'll bring them in the greenhouse tonight. So that's the thing with the showering and with the washing of leaves and all of that. It's nice, it's good. The orchids will love it. But we need to be mindful because this is cultivation, this is not nature. We're playing by totally different rules. We can't expect them to behave like nature. Some of these guys are hybrids. This is a hybrid, the gigabell. You'll not find it in nature. How do I know how it's going to respond to stuff that species will respond in a certain way? If the gene pool is a little bit mixed up here, I don't even trust it. So we have to keep all of those things in mind and be safe. And I'm speaking from experience here. If you're not careful, such as I was, you will have major issues. And you guys saw, I had a lot of issues with crown rot. Not only with the fowls, but with other orchids. Let's remember the Huntleia here, which I'm very sad about. Just because I wasn't careful. I was overconfident in the weather and in what I was doing, and I was very wrong. So learn from that and be careful with water in the crowns and stuff. And I wanted to address this because this is one of the most common comments that I get whenever I talk about crown rot. And some comments can get very abrasive or antagonists, really, and there's no point. If you don't believe you can get crown rot, go ahead and do what you want. When you do get crown rot, though, act fast and search for my videos on crown rot. Anyway, so with that said, thank you guys so much for watching. Hope you've enjoyed this. I'll keep you up to date. So far, so good with the Gemma Light. I'm Wow, I'm impressed. I have to say I'm impressed. Thank you so much for watching. Hope you've enjoyed this. Subscribe to my channel for more orchid videos, tutorials, experiments, updates, and other fun orchid subjects. If you wish to support the channel, do consider becoming a member or visit the merch store linked down below in the description. You can also follow me on Instagram and Facebook. It's always nice to stay in touch there as well.
And with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye!